Please welcome back Eugène Green. So I'd like to begin by asking about Mathieu Amalric's participation in the film. I think it's often a bit surprising when a very recognizable, well-known actor appears in one of your films for some reason. And you know, it's a similar feeling that I had when Jeremy Renier turned up in Le Pont des Arts. Could you speak a bit about how Amalric became involved in the film and sort of incorporating an actor like him into your system?
Well, the actors are always professional actors in my films, and it's not the first time actually that I work with Mathieu, because he was in a long short, I think you say, a moyen métrage that I made in 2006, Les Signes, which was at Cannes. And in Le Pont des Arts, there were quite a few actors, well-known actors. Natacha Régnier aussi is a well-known actress. And there was Denis Podalides et Olivier Gourmet and Jérémy Régnier. It's the same thing. The actors with whom I work have to accept the language, the specific language that I use. But Mathieu, he saw my first film, Toutes les Nuits, when it came out in 2001, and he liked it very much, and he told me that he would like to work with me if there was a possibility. And so we had the two possibilities in Les Signes and now. So there's not any difference when I work with him or when I work with actors like Christelle Pro or Adrien Michaud, with whom I've worked often. He has to make a certain effort not to, because he usually moves a great deal, and he has a certain personal way of acting. But he was happy to do this, and I think he expresses it as much or even more perhaps than when he's in the films of Desplechin or someone like that.
And two more names that will be quite familiar to New York Film Festival audiences are, of course, Jean-Pierre and Luc Dardenne, who co-produced the film. And I think that also might surprise some people, considering how different their work, their own films are than yours. Could you talk about that relationship?
Well, first of all, it's not the first time that they co-produced one of my films. They co-produced Le Monde Vivant in 2002-03. And actually, they wanted to co-produce Le Pont des Arts et La Sapienza, but they didn't find the money in Belgium. But it's not really, that is, people think that their cinema is social cinema because it takes place in, the characters are always people who live in precarious situations, and in their native town of Seraing in Belgium, which is an industrial working class town. But actually, they by other means they try to do the same thing that I do. That is, by filming the exterior of things to capture the hidden part, the interior. And also there's that's also, it's in, especially in France, it's not ever recognized, but there's a spiritual dimension in all of their films, with Christian references actually. For example, in the film I don't know how you translate it in English, the child with a...
L'enfant?
The child with a bicycle.
The kid with the bike.
The kid with the bike. once I heard Luc making an analyze, talking about the film, and he said, for example, that for him, the first time that the child comes into contact with the young woman who's going to take care of him, he's running out of an office, and he falls into her arms. And for Luc, it was like his reference, his visual reference, was a form of pietà, the representation of the Virgin Mary holding her dead son. And at the end of that film, that's also something which is not recognized very much in France, but there's a resurrection at the end of the film, because the child who falls from a tree and who is obviously dead, suddenly he gets up and he walks away. So they actually, I like the cinema very much, and they like mine. It's, and they told me they would be very happy to co-produce other films if they can.
And some of what you were just saying concerning spirituality, Christian motifs, and this sense of interiority inevitably reminds one of Bresson, who's of course big. I think a big point of reference or inspiration for both you and the Dardens, but very differently. I think a bit like Bresson, sometimes your films are described as being formalist, and I was wondering what you think of that.
Yes, that's. But actually, art is form. Otherwise, it's not art. So, we live in a world where everything is reduced to a sort of tele-reality.
Some sort of mediated reality.
Yeah, I think it's this. It's going on now. During the, I think you were very courageous to come and see the screening, rather to watch the debate between. But everything becomes a sort of reality show, The question, excuse me, the question was
just about what you make of people referring to your films as formalist.
That's also another word they use often is maniere in French, mannered, but maniérisme was. First of all, the word maniere in French, maniera in Italian, it's a word which means style. And the fact of having a style, so something original, used to be considered to be a quality for artists. And today, where everything is, so many films, especially French films, seem to be made by logiciel, say software. You can almost invent a sort of software to make the two types of French films. Because in France we produce 200 films about a year, French films, without counting the French investment in foreign films. But out of the 200 films, at least two-thirds of them correspond of one of two models, either the social film taking place in the suburbs, mainly the suburbs of Paris, but it's not a social film like the films of the Dardenne. It's a very formatted kind of social film which tells you what is good and what is evil. And then the other kind, and it's usually made by people who live in one of the posh districts of Paris. And the other kind of French film is about the psychological problems of a bourgeois intellectual couple who live in a rich district of Paris. And it's not made by someone who lives in the working class suburb. Those films have no form, specific form, because they're always the same. But I think that all of the cineasts whom I admire the most, they have a very specific language. You can, seeing just two or three shots of one of their films, you know it's their film. Like a great writer, you read one page and you can, without looking at the signature, you know who wrote it. And so I assume. I don't think that it's a fault to have a form, but it's something which is qui m'est reproché. C'est sort of blame. Thank you.
And I would like to ask you about literature in just a second, but before I do, I did want to mention that if you enjoyed Son of Joseph, it is opening around the corner at the Eleanor Buna Monroe Film Center on January 13th, so please spread the word. And now, I'd like to ask about sort of the place of literature in this film, because in your previous films, there is an engagement with other art forms beyond cinema, like, for instance, architecture in La Sapienza, music in the Portuguese Nun, and so on. But here you're dealing with the contemporary world of literature for the first time, I think. I was wondering.
Yes, probably. Yes.
Yeah. So I was wondering. I was curious what motivated that and sort of how you were thinking about it as you.
Well, Paul Menor, he had to be something, and I wanted him to be something in. One of the part of the French intellectual world, which has a great prestige in France, and to show that someone who participates in what is considered to be culturally prestigious is someone who is very empty inside. And it happens that I'm also here. Probably, if you've ever seen another of my films, you may consider me to be a filmmaker, but I'm also a writer. I have about 15 books published, and so I do have a certain acquaintance with the publishing world in Paris. And I didn't invent anything in the film. It's one of the particularities of French civilization that culture and literature in particular have a great prestige in France, but which is good, but there's around it this is sort of a sort of world which is represented in the film and which really has nothing to do with literature or with culture, and literature becomes simply a power, an area of power, and there are people who use literature as an area of power in the same way that people use finance or politics to become powerful and rich.
And we can take some questions from the audience.
We were lucky to watch La Sapienza here, and I was fascinated there, as I am here, by the way that you photograph fantastic buildings and also other works of art like paintings here. But specifically, I want to ask you, why are you specifically fascinated by the Baroque works of art, which I think that predominate at least in this and obviously in La Sapienza?
Yes, well, it's something I did very deep research actually on the Baroque period. There was a practical reason because before I started making films or having my books published, I did theater for more than 20 years. And it wasn't the only thing that I did in theater, but I had a specialty of Baroque theater. I tried to do for the theater what the musicians did for the music of the period, that is to come the closest possible to the way it was done when it was new theater. But there was something, actually, there was a personal reason which is much deeper. It's a bit complicated to explain, but and we don't have too much time, I think, but I'll try to do it quickly. The Baroque period, for me, gives an answer to contemporary man to a question which has never been really resolved in our civilization. Because in the Middle Ages and in the Renaissance, there was no contradiction between the exploration, the rational exploration of the world, what we call scientific investigation, and spiritual belief, because people believed that the world was a creation of God, and that God was visible in every element of his creation. Any element of the world was a microcosm in which you can find on a small scale the same thing as the macrocosm, the universe. But beginning in the middle of the 16th century, scientific development had gone so far that it tended towards the construction of a purely rational model of the universe, where things worked simply according to natural laws, like a machine. And that seemed to evacuate the necessity of God. But during all the Baroque period, from the end of the 16th until the beginning of the 18th century, people lived an oxymoron in English. An oxymoron is a figure of rhetoric where you put together two elements which reason considers to be contradictory and exclusive to express something which goes beyond reason. For example, there's a famous line of Corneille in the Le Cid. Cette obscure clarté, je dis avec la, I say it with a baroque pronunciation. Cette obscure clarté qui tombe des étoiles. That obscure clarity which falls from the stars. An obscure clarity is an oxymoron because what is obscure seems to exclude clarity, and what is clear excludes obscurity. But he put them together to describe the light of the stars. And so the Baroque man lived an oxymoron in permanence because he continued to develop the modern model of the universe, which seemed to make the universe function like a machine, simply. But he believed that the highest reality was God, but God was no longer visible in the world. It was the Deus absconditus of Pascal, the hidden God. And God only appeared in certain moments when the natural laws of nature were suspended. And in the theater, man was able to reproduce the reality through something completely false, but he was able to make the hidden God appear in the theater. And so the theater became the model for all Baroque art, actually. So for me, it gives a possibility to live in the modern world with a spiritual life, but without being closed in a psychiatrical hospital, because someone who refuses completely the rationalistic vision of the universe is always considered to be mad. And so that's the main reason, the personal reason in any case, for my interest in the Baroque civilization.
Do you feel that in your working methods and sort of, for lack of a better way to put it, I'll describe as your stylistic system, that you that you're striving towards that kind of Baroque ideal that you were just describing?
I read that my films are Baroque cinema. I don't know what that means, because Baroque is a historical period, and I was born in the 20th century, and now we're in the 21st. So, I don't know. I, in any case, I don't consciously strive to imitate anything from the Baroque. It's something which comes to me directly. In a general way, I consider that an artist, in any case myself, that I'm just a sort of artisan, actually, because without something which comes from the exterior, I wouldn't be able to do what I do. And the basis for all my stories in the films or in the novels, it's always something which comes from elsewhere, and then I develop it, but it always comes from elsewhere. And the stylistic thing, it's a little bit the same thing. It seemed necessary to me for what I wanted to do, to do it that way. I did it that way for my first film, Toutes les Nuits, that it satisfied me, and so I don't, for the time being in any case, and I don't think I'd have very much time left, so it's probably up until the end, it satisfies me, and I don't see a necessity for changing.
And we can take a couple more questions from the audience.
I'm sort of always fascinated by pacing in movies.
A little louder. The time on the paintings or in general?
But I think generally the way that you render, like, temporality.
The temporality. Well, also because that's one of the problems. We live in a world where the present doesn't exist. If you go out in the street, you see people, all the people in the street, it's the same thing in Paris, they're all with their mobile phones. They're either, they have music in their ears, or else they're looking at the phone or talking to someone who isn't there. And so they have no contact with their present time. But the present is the most important time, because the present contains all that has been and all that will be. The present is a continual and eternal time which never stops. So I try to give you during the projection a present which will enable you to see more deeply into the reality of the present in the world, in your present also. And so that means you have to take your time. When you see, I saw part of the presentation of the festival. I think it's well done. It's a good presentation. But there were excerpts of films, and you could never, you didn't have the time to see what the image was. Then it's the idea of the clips that you. You just have to make images pass, but people are afraid of stopping. People are afraid of looking into things, and so I think that at least for the 2 hours of, that a film takes, you can give yourself the possibility of taking your time and looking at things. And so that's what I filmed the paintings. There was a general view of each painting, and then I wanted you be able to look at it as when you're in a museum, for example, you have a general view of a painting, and then you start looking at details, and you start as understanding more and more about what the painting is, what it expresses. And so that's what, since Vincent and Joseph are looking at the painting, I wanted you to be able to have the same experience as they do. And it's the same thing with any sort of frame that I do. I want to take the time to go into what is hidden behind the appearance of reality.
I was curious whether you had the Caravaggio painting in mind all along, because the sacrifice of Abraham, because it gestures in the direction of the film's spiritual concerns and sort of the biblical points of reference in the film.
Well, yes. When the idea came to me for the basis of the film, which afterwards I developed, the essential element was a boy who doesn't know who his father was and who is obsessed by that, and the idea of the painting of Caravaggio, the sacrifice of Abraham, and a relation between the two.
I had the pleasure of seeing your other film, Sapienza, here a year ago. And I noticed a similarity between this film and that. And then you seem to always have a young man who is being taught by a strange older man or a father figure. It seems like that's a recurring theme. And I just wonder what's behind that, if there is any.
Well, it's in those two films that situation exists. I don't think it exists in my other films, but it corresponds to something which is very important in all of my films and my books also, I think. It's the idea of transmission, which is an essential element of civilization. Civilization is the transmission from one generation to another. And one of the tragedies of our contemporary world is that transmission has been interrupted. And there's very little transmission from one generation to another. And in my generation, there was a real interruption of transmission, so that the succeeding generations, if they want to find what is behind their culture, what is behind their history, they have to look for it themselves, whereas that should be a normal part of life, in fact. And as I said when I was presenting the La Sapienza, the transmission is always in both directions, and an adult can transmit what he knows to someone who is young, to an adolescent, but the adolescent is closer to the reality, to the most important reality, actually, spiritual reality, by intuition, and so he enables the adult to find again the state of what he was when he was an adolescent, and so it's something which is very beneficial in both directions, and so it does come in that form in these last two films, but in my earlier films it's present, the idea is present, but in other ways.
And we have time for one more question.
Thank you very much for this. Very interesting film. It's the first film of yours that I've seen. And one thing that struck me profoundly was that the film starts with the traffic covering the view, making the picture very busy and sort of unpleasant. And it ends up with the big space of the sea. To me, it sounded like the idea of purification. Maybe clarification or sort of escaping from this everyday crazy world to some higher plane. So I don't know, that was my reaction. Would you comment on that?
Yeah, well, the images of the cars at the beginning, and the fact that they're very close and rather oppressive that way, it corresponds to the state of Vincent at the beginning of the film, and his world opens up once he in the moment of grace when he refuses to commit the act of vengeance and killing his biological father, and when he meets right afterwards Joseph, and his world does open up, and the film ends before the sea, so which is of course an image of great openness and of possibility towards something future. So I think you did receive an important element of the film simply through the images which you just described.
Well, it sounds like a number of members of the audience were here for La Sapienza a couple of years ago, or last year when we opened it. I'm sure they're all wondering what the next film will be and when you'll come back and show it to them.
Well, I made a documentary which hasn't been released yet about the Basques, which I hope it will be seen. And I have two projects. I have lots of screenplays which are written, but you have to find the financing for them, which is the most difficult part. But I have two projects where there's a producer who is trying to get the financing for them, in which I hope to realize both of them in 2017. One of them is a short film, which I hope to shoot in Lisbon in Portuguese. It's about an anecdote of the life of the poet Fernando Pessoa, which I rediscovered. I had known it actually before, but I wrote a short book about Pessoa, and I rediscovered this anecdote. It's a very amusing anecdote. And the second one is a feature film, which is based on a Basque myth. And I wrote the screenplay in French, but I would like it to be translated into Basque, and I would like to shoot it in Basque. So those would be the two next projects if the producer finds the money.
Well, I'm sure we all hope so. So thank you, Eugène.
Thank you.